So the high level numbers on savings, on capitalization, on reserves have all moved in the right direction since this process began. And I would say that officers have already demonstrated a very high degree of caution in framing this budget. But many of their proposals are genuine savings. And I'd like to acknowledge the very long hours that officers have put in to identify those savings that take costs out without impacting services. And some savings are especially welcome, from the extra capacity for looked after children to the elimination of public firework displays. And I've said, I've got some additional proposals to bring at the appropriate time. So I'd just like to conclude with a few questions for the Director of Finance. The addition of a contingency fund pressure has hugely restricted the scope of members to mitigate these cuts or provide adequate breathing space to properly explore and support alternatives, including community asset transfers. And we've heard that from other members, and we heard it repeatedly in some of the questions that were asked at the beginning of the meeting. On page 176, it says that 15% of the full savings total is regarded as a prudent contingency amount. However, at £3 million, the contingency is now 16.5% of total savings. This additional 1.5% amounts to £270,000. A 10% contingency in line with commercial norms would free up £1.2 million. And I would repeat what the Director of Finance said earlier, that additional scrutiny is working well. And we saw in the first report on revenue monitoring that savings have improved and the capitalisation figure has come down. And one could conclude that the contingency has actually been set at a level to deny members any real scope to address the more damaging impacts of these proposals. Not just the high-profile closures of leisure and libraries and leisure centres, but also cuts to youth provision, street cleaning, antisocial behaviour support, higher charges for important environmental services, the climate emergency budget, that could go on. So my specific questions are, what is the basis for a 15% contingency, including the appropriate evidence base, given that we were told that all proposals had a very rigorous internal and external scrutiny? And why has it not been applied at 15% as referenced in the report?
So if I may, I'll come in first, Councillor Cleary. So clarification was sought with the independent panel over the contingency fund, as I stated earlier. Initially it was 15% when the number was higher. The chair of the independent panel and other members, including the peer panel members, have made it absolutely clear that £3 million is the number, and two members that if a decision was taken to reduce that number, that would be reflected in the report to the budget council. But when the independent chair presents their next report, and also the report to the Secretary of State. So the £3 million is the minimum that is expected to be in that contingency fund.
Sorry, just to briefly come back, if I could, just very briefly. I would just say that, you know, the independent panel saying that it should be £3 million is not providing an evidence base. You know, it's just saying that's what it should be. It's not actually explaining why it should be 15%. It's repeated many times in the report that the function of the independent panel is to review, to comment, to support, and not to dictate. So I think, you know, we don't have to absolutely accept to the last letter everything they say. We do have powers, officers have the powers to refine as appropriate. Thanks.
So my job as Chief Executive is to provide advice to you as members. It's your decision to decide whatever decision that might be. But I'm strongly advising you evolve that the opinion of the independent panel is what I've said it is, and the independent panel reports separately to the Secretary of State. And we know potential consequences both for officers and for members in terms of what that might mean. But it is obviously within a democratic process, and it's for members to take the advice of officers and to decide what they need to do.
I'm glad this has been discussed tonight, because it's something that I raised last week quite forcefully around the same issue, Councillor Cleary. I was given the same advice. I'm going to bring Councillor Anderson in.
Just on the back of it, I think everybody's raised that issue. As a group, no one wants to cut any services, but we just have to look at the record, and sadly over the last decade, shortfall, and it was at 27 million. As Councillor Cleary is well aware, that thankfully, it, you know, it's 18, it's not great, but it's better than where we were, and we're not having to face some of those issues. Now, the 3 million, I actually have to concur with what the Chief Executive just said, the independent panel members and our peer reviews in the LGA, that it is the minimum, in my view. To make this amount of savings in 1 year, with some of the expiration of transfers, the issues that may come up, is going to be extremely challenging. And what we don't want to be, we need to reset this base budget to take out the structural deficit, and that there is a contingency that will allow us to do it. So next year, we're not having to go to, we heard about the golf courses earlier. I chaired that, the committee, the scrutiny committee first, and then the tourism, and Councillor Cameron, as she said, every year they've been put on the table and it's not been fair. We need to reset that base budget so it's sensible going forward. And if we don't have that 3 million to help deliver, then it's just going to add on top of that, and I'm not prepared to be there. It will be irresponsible.
We don't see any further hands up, so as I said earlier, I'm going to read to committee the alterations that are coming from the library. Just before I go through them, I'd like to say that, as members have said tonight, this budget has been like no other in memory. I'm aware of, and we've spent days and weeks trying to find solutions to keep our services running or to mitigate against the worst of the cuts. The idea that these cuts are a choice, a political choice, is both unsubstantiated and actually I find really offensive that anybody sitting in this room around this table tonight would choose to do this. It is a real insult to us and our integrity, quite honestly. I'm going to propose a series of alterations to the recommendations presented to us, and in the Labour Group's opinion, they will serve to mitigate some of the harshest cuts, but that doesn't mean to say we're not continuing to explore every avenue to find ways to save more. We're listening to residents and we're desperate to do what we can within the confines of where we are at the moment in terms of the improvement panel, in terms of government watching us, and in terms of the level of cuts we've been told to make. I'm just going to read through a series of alterations, and these have been subject to discussion with Chair Harewood, who I'll invite to comment at the end. So the first one is the statement proposal listed at Appendix 2, headed permanent closure and demolition of Woodchurch Leisure Centre, be amended to contain an additional element to that proposal, which is the demolition of Woodchurch Leisure Centre will not be progressed whilst the process is undergone to consider the feasibility of expressions of interest submitted to the Council by the 30th of September 2022, the transfer of the leisure centre to be operated by a community group or trust. Any transfer of the leisure centre will include the earmarked capital costs of £330,000 for demolition being made available to assist with required capital maintenance works to the site. In addition, if the Directorate is able to make any efficiencies above and beyond the proposed savings at the end of quarter one in 22-23, that this will also be earmarked towards project support for any successful bid to transfer the facility to a community organisation. This does not affect the proposed revenue saving. I'm really hopeful on this one, as I know there's been some really positive work done behind the scenes with Ward Councillor Robinson and myself, and there's been various interested parties which we think we can help with this one. It's a hugely precious asset to the community, and it's something that we're really keen to see flourish, despite the fact that the council has not got the adequate funding to just keep that open on its own. The next one is that report be brought as soon as practicable to the Policy and Resources Committee to establish a community asset transfer policy in respect of services and assets identified in the budget proposals, which should be fully integrated with the Council's community wealth building strategy and the principles adopted within it. We've spoken about asset transfer here. This refers specifically to the Woodchurch Leisure Centre, which I've just spoken about. I think any asset transfer policy has to be equitable and be available where help be available to any group that would like to bid into that. The next one is that the savings proposal listed as Appendix 2 headed Review of Antisocial Behaviour Team be deleted. This will remove the proposal of £50,000 to review the antisocial behaviour team, as the committee is acutely aware of the blight that antisocial behaviour has on our residents' lives and the detrimental impact it has on our communities. The £50,000 attached to this saving may be found from a different resource, that being using the annual community safety grant, which the council receives from the Police and Crime Commissioner, which is as yet unallocated for 2022-23. This will both protect our communities and save lives. Next alteration is that the Director for Neighbourhoods ensures that the forthcoming reports to Tourism Communities, Culture and Leisure Committee contain. A full exploration of all proposals submitted during the consultation period for Hoylake and Brackenwood golf courses, including options for increasing fees, alternative provision and environmental projects. Delivery plans for children's activity in the main swimming pool at your local pools on dedicated days of school holidays, and a consideration of how future leisure provision may be underpinned by the community wealth building strategy and is best able to deliver the Wirral plan objective to reduce health inequalities in the borough. The next one is that expressions of interest to be invited for the transfer of one or more golf courses to a community run body to be submitted by the 30th of September 2022 to be developed as a business case and assessed by the council. This will not affect the saving proposal to come into effect as of the 1st of April 2022. And finally, that a report be brought to a future meeting of the Policy and Resources Committee in respect of a review of the council's social value policy, which is requested to take place within the coming 6 months and focuses on an ambition to make it, to increase the targets to make the social value policy more ambitious and to integrate with the social value framework currently being developed by the Liverpool City Region. They are the alterations to the officer recommendations for the budget this year. I just invite you now over to confirm that these have been discussed and signed off.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I can confirm. I've had an opportunity to review the proposals and assess them, validate them in advance, and in my opinion, they are all legal and deliverable for 2022.
Chair, might I make a suggestion that we have all our individual ones and then open that up to comments, because that might help facilitate the debate.
Yeah, I think that's probably better. Do I have a seconder for that? Councillor Hugh Robinson.
Chair, just before you move forward, as has been said, these have been shared with Chair and I, so they have been produced and printed out. If we can share the copies of those with members and give members a moment to study them before you move any further forward.
Thanks, Justin, Jim.